Söyleşiye geçmeden önce Kadir Has Üniversitesi Rektörlüğü'ne destekleri için özellikle teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Aynı zamanda bu etkinliğin yapılmasını sağlamak için gerek öncesinde gayretlerini esirgemeyen, gerekse bugün bir pazar günü burada olup bu etkinliğin gerçekleşmesine katkı sunan Kadir Has çalışanlarına da özellikle teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Söyleşiyi İngilizce yapacağız ama daha geniş bir kitleye ulaşabilmesini sağlamak için bugün bize çeviri desteği sunacak olan Forum Danışmanlık ve Çeviri Hizmetleri ile Sungur Savran hocamıza da ayrıca teşekkürlerimi iletmem gerekiyor. Son olarak da etkinliğin organizasyonu için bugün moderatörlüğü de yapacak olan Anıl Abay'a ve tüm detayları organize eden, o olmasaydı etkinliği yapamayacağımız sevgili öğrenci asistanımız Çağdaş Yalçınkaya'ya da teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Buraya beni dinlemeye gelmediğinizi biliyorum. O yüzden uzatmayacağım açılış konuşmasını. Yanis'in de zaten çok fazla tanıtıma ihtiyacı yok. Kendisi dünya gündemine Syriza'nın Maliye Bakanı olarak geldi ama öncesinde ve sonrasında da iktisat alanında pek değerli eserler üretmiş bir iktisatçı. İngiltere'de, Amerika Birleşik Devletleri'nde, Avustralya'da ve Yunanistan'da bir dizi üniversitede iktisat dersleri verdi. Birçok yayını, birçok kitabı zaten dünyada dolaşıyor. Bunların bazıları Türkçe'ye de çevrilmiş durumda. Özellikle bir eser üzerinde kısaca birkaç şey söylemek istiyorum. Adults in the Room eseri. Odadaki yetişkinler, Avrupalı ve Amerikalı derin egemen çevrelerle Muharebem başlıklı kitabı. Bu kitabı ben aslında hararetle tavsiye ediyorum. Çünkü dünya düzeninin kapalı kapılar ardında nasıl işlediği, kitlelerin arzusu hilafına sınırların nasıl çizildiği, yapısal reformların nasıl dayatıldığı, liberal demokrasi ile neoliberal ekonominin, liberal demokrasinin kadife eldiveni ile neoliberal ekonominin demir yumruğunun birlikte nasıl çalıştığını mükemmel bir örnek. Costa Gavras'ın deyişiyle bu trajedinin nasıl mümkün olduğunu, makinenin nasıl çalıştığını detaylarıyla ortaya seriyor. Neoliberal iktisat uygulamalarının demokratik görünümlü siyasal mekanizmalarını Avrupa bağlamında anlamak isteyenler için müthiş bir kaynak olduğu kanaatindeyim. Aslında biz Costa Gavras bu kitabın filmini de çekti. Biz filmi de göstermek istedik bugün ama anladığımız kadarıyla bir takım kurallardan ötürü gösteremiyoruz. Çünkü filmin ilk gösteriminin önümüzdeki İstanbul Film Festivali'nde yapılması gerekiyormuş. Kitabın bildiğim kadarıyla henüz Türkçesi yok ama ilgilenenler için benim 1+1'de internette mevcut olan Kadife Eldiven Demir Yumruk başlıklı kısa bir özetim de var. Onu da tavsiye edebilirim. I'd like to thank Yanis for being with us today and I'll just leave the stage to him and Anıl. Geldiğiniz için hepinize teşekkür ediyorum tekrar.
All right, so hello and welcome one more time. Thanks for your attention, thanks for your attendance. We were not expecting this much of a crowd today. I see some people even standing here. So, Yanis, I also have to thank you for accepting our invitation. It's an honor to have you here in this university and it's a pleasure for me to speak with you. So let's kick it off, if you like, with neoliberalism. Okay, I mean, many mainstream thinkers, intellectuals, academicians, politicians, tend to reject the term, the concept, the entire concept of neoliberalism, saying that this is how it's supposed to be. This is what the theory dictates as the, you know, best policies, like free markets, financialization, capital mobility and everything. So what's the big deal about it on one side? On the other side of the spectrum, Marxists, some Marxists, if not all, tend to agree with them, saying that this is what just capitalism is about, like lowering wages, income inequality, wealth inequality, environmental damage, insecure jobs. So there's nothing new or there's nothing liberal about it. Like this is just simply capitalism, how it works, what it does to people. So what is the point of separating the capitalist history into episodes and giving, you know, different names. It's just a distraction from our political struggle. But regardless, we are in this together, and there are clear signs, obvious signs that it is in decline. It is losing its credibility, losing its popular, moral, and intellectual legitimacy. So what's your take on this? Like, how do you see the current state of neoliberalism and its near foreseeable future? Yanis.
Good evening. It's wonderful to be here. It's always, you know, 5 years ago, our life was transformed. We went from, well, I went from being an academic to being a politician. I don't recommend it. Don't do it if you are academics. It happened because of a major crisis. We'll still live through it in Greece. You live it here in Turkey. We live it everywhere, which is connected to neoliberalism. Speaking personally, it's always wonderful to come back to university because this is my natural habitat as a, you know, as an animal. My natural habitat is the university. And it's the joy is twice as much because I happen to be not only in a university but also in Istanbul, which is the most beautiful and spectacular city in the world. It's always wonderful to come back to Istanbul. I never flatter an audience as a strategy, so I'm not flattering you. I was in Ghent in Belgium the other day and I said, what a horrible place this is. So take it for granted, I mean it. Okay, neoliberalism. Now, Anil, every regime has its myth. It's legitimizing story. You know, the Soviet Union had Marx. If Marx existed, was alive in Moscow, he would be in the Gulag. The first person they would arrest and throw in prison would be Marx. And yet, every Soviet leader was referring to Karl Marx. If Marx appeared today in Beijing, that is, he would disappear in the prison system. So the theory which is utilized by a regime in order to legitimize what it does usually is utterly disconnected from what the regime actually does. Let's look at capitalism. The legitimizing story that I was taught when I was a young man, before neoliberalism took over. You know, the liberal story. The liberal story is founded on Adam Smith, the original political economist who legitimized capitalism. What was the story in Adam Smith? The story was that, yes, nobody likes capitalists. Nobody likes people who look after themselves. But if you have the market, and the market is competitive, and you have the butcher, the baker, and the brewer, this is the three professions that Adam Smith mentions in The Wealth of Nations, and each one of them looks after themselves, they will provide the community with the best bread, the best beer, and the best meat at the lowest prices, not because they care for the public, but it's the best way for them to look after themselves, and in looking after themselves, they look after the public interest in the best possible way. So this is the philosophical contradiction, but also beauty of Adam Smith's story, that the public interest is best served when no one is trying to serve it. Because those who proclaim, you know, the President of the Republic, the Prime Minister, the King, those who proclaim to work for the public never do. They are all liars. They're all in it for themselves. So if you have the market is an instrument, it's a tool. It allows people, in pursuing their own private interest, completely honestly, to produce public goods. That was the original story for legitimizing capitalism. If you compare this with neoliberalism, why is neoliberalism different to liberalism? It is different. In one important way, if you look at it as, you know, as a mythology. The mythology after Thatcher and Reagan is fundamentally different to the mythology of Adam Smith in one important way, even though they all talk about Adam Smith. The market is no longer, since the 1970s, the market no longer appeared as a useful instrument. Because think about it, if the market is an instrument, then there must be someone who knows what it should be used for. Mm-hmm. So if you have a hammer, the hammer doesn't have a mind. It is useful for hammering things, okay? But somebody must know what needs to be hammered, okay? So that's the original idea of Adam Smith. The market is a hammer. We know what the public interest is. It is cheaper commodities, larger quantities, education that should be provided by the state. That was Adam Smith. But it means that there is a society with a morality and with aspirations of what it wants, and then the market is the hammer with which you fix it. You fix those things. But after the 1970s, the mid-1970s, the market was transformed from the instrument to the objective. The market was God. It was not the instrument of God. And they had to do this, you know, because remember Margaret Thatcher once, when she gave an interview, this has become very famous, that interview. It was to a women's magazine called Woman's Own. The journalist asked her, but Mrs. Thatcher, Prime Minister, you know, your policies have resulted in 4 million unemployed people, in the destruction of so many communities. Surely, they can't be good for society. And she responded brilliantly. She said, my dear, there is no such thing as society. There are individuals and families. What she meant was that it is impossible to work out what society wants. I know what I want, you know what you want, but what we all want, this aggregation, is impossible. So the public interest does not exist. So suddenly, Adam Smith is rejected. The market is not an instrument for the purposes of serving the public interest, because the public interest does not exist. My interest contradicts with yours, so what is our interest? There's no such thing. So suddenly, the market becomes from a very useful instrument to the goal, to the objective. That's at the level of philosophy. The philosophy of neoliberalism. But now there is the reality. Because as I said before, neoliberalism has as much to do with the world we live in as Marxism had to do with the Soviet Union. Nothing. Zero. No relationship whatsoever. You know, same as, you know, the relationship between the Spanish Inquisition and Jesus Christ. Zero. Yeah? The relationship between the Prophet and what ISIS is doing. Zero, right? No relationship. They use him or it for the purposes of legitimizing whatever it is that they do. So what is the reality? The notion of competitive capitalism that Adam Smith was referring to died in around 1870, 1880. At a time when electromagnets were used for the Second Industrial Revolution to create telegraph poles and, you know, telegraph systems, telephony. Later with Edison, electricity, grids, companies that produced from the light bulb to the huge power generating station. Those companies could not be competitive. They were monopolies. So the idea of the brewer, the baker, and the butcher goes and is replaced by Edison, you know, by General Electric, by Ford, today by Google, Facebook,
Amazon,
and so on. Eh? That is not competitive capitalism. It's a market of monopolists. And the monopolists now even own the market. If you think of Facebook is a marketplace. You enter into Facebook, you pay money, you know, you transact with other people, you are in a market space that belongs to one company. So Adam Smith is dead, in other words, spiritually as well. The moment we enter that world, and we enter that world at around 1900, from 1870s to 1900, suddenly, because the companies are huge, net worth companies like Edison, General Electric, because they're huge, they need a lot of money to finance them. So the little banks are no longer capable of providing the big banks, the big companies, the huge amounts of money necessary. So the banks consolidate, become, so you have mega banks and mega companies. The mega banks can create money out of nothing, create huge quantities of fictional money, which is provided to the mega firms that utilize that in order to produce their commodities, their services. But at some point, the huge quantities of money that are produced by the mega banks cannot be serviced. Those debts cannot be serviced by the mega firms, because the mega firms have large profits for themselves, but pay very little wages, and they constrict supply to maximize their profits. So suddenly there is a, what Marx referred to as a realization problem, and you have 1929. The whole system collapses. And what saved it beyond the war? It was all those institutions, the purpose of which was to restrict banking under the New Deal of Roosevelt and then Bretton Woods, restrict banking, regulate capitalism to save capitalism. They were not anti-capitalists, those people. They were smart capitalists. So they realized that in order to serve capitalism from itself, you've got to constrict it and restrict it and constrain it. Okay? So we had a period of 25 years of diminishing inequality, mixed economy, with socialist elements of capitalism to save capitalism.
Higher growth rates.
Yeah, that's right. But that system relied on the United States of America after the war. Because after the war, it was this global plan. It was a planned economy with the American dollar at the center. And America was the only surplus country. Europe was in ashes after the World War. It was American surpluses that were being transferred to Europe and to Japan, not out of philanthropy, but because it was the only way that the Europeans and the Japanese could buy American things, so as to keep the American production machine going, recycling. But that ended when the Americans entered a deficit, went from a surplus to being a deficit country. With the rise of Germany, of Japan, suddenly they became a deficit. So the whole thing collapsed in 1971. And we had a new phase. And that new phase was the phase of neoliberalism. Why? Because the new phase depended on a reversal of the flow of goods and money. Up until 1971, America was the net exporter. It was exporting more to Europe than it was importing. And money was going from America to Europe. Money and goods were going from America to Europe. And because money was coming to Europe, the thing of the Marshall Aid Plan, for instance, it was going back to the United States to purchase American aeroplanes, tanks, cars. They were exporting cars back then, electronics, and so on. Then after the end of Bretton Woods, we had the complete opposite. We had America running a larger and larger trade deficit. Okay, so effectively, the United States was sucking into its territory the net exports of Germany, Holland, Italy, Japan, and later China. And who was financing that deficit of the United States? We were, the rest of the world, because we were sending capitalists in the West, Western Europe, Japan, China, were sending their money to the United States. So huge quantities of money were going to Wall Street to finance the American machine. And on the back of that huge quantity of money going into Wall Street, American bankers built wonderful palaces and pyramids of financialization. All those toxic, you know, financialization is? It's really something really very simple. You give the financier 10 euros, $10, and they make 100 out of it by dividing and multiplying it through derivatives and stuff. Okay, at some point all this thing came crashing down. Before it came down. So, but to do this, to finance world capitalism that way, through Wall Street, they had to liberate Wall Street from all the constraints that Roosevelt and the post-war era had placed upon the bankers. They needed an ideology for this emancipation, liberation of the bankers. And the ideology came from neoliberalism, from the narrative that the market is not just an instrument, it is an objective. So the reason why now neoliberalism is in retreat, you mentioned that now it's being challenged, is because after 2008, that model, that global recycling system broke down. And it is not finding a way of reproducing itself. So austerity for the many and socialism for the bankers, which is neoliberalism, that's what it is, it's socialism. Neoliberalism is very active socialism for the very few. So for the very few, when they have profits, it's their profits. When they have their losses, society has to give them money. That's socialism. You look after the ones who have the greatest losses. Socialism for the bankers and for the very rich. And, you know, the arena of the unfettered market in which you can only lose for the many. Now, this is not even working now. I mean, I like numbers instead of mythical concepts. People say, why did Donald Trump win the election in the United States? We can go into a long discussion about identity, about gender, about race. I get bored. Do you know why Donald Trump won? Because for the first time in American history, more than half of the families in the United States could not afford the cheapest car on the market. That's why he won. People were angry and they said, okay, how do we annoy the privilege in Washington and in New York, those who read the New York Times, we vote for the one person they hate the most. That's why he won, right? So, and similarly, why is neoliberalism in such deep trouble? Ideologically, even the Financial Times is challenging neoliberalism. The reason is 18 trillion, not billion, 18 trillion, 18,000 billion dollars of debt is now receiving negative interest rates. Now you only have to state that to know that capitalism, the neoliberal model of capitalism, is in serious trouble. Do you understand what negative interest rates means? It means that you come to me and you say, here is 100 lira, take it and promise to give me back 98. That's what it means. Why would you ever do that? I mean, it makes no sense. You would never do it. Never. Unless you are my friend. Then it's a gift. Right? So why do banks pay negative interest rates for in their billions? Simply because, you know, unlike, I mean, you can give 100 lira to me, but, you know, how do you give 2 billion? It doesn't fit in a suitcase. You know, you don't walk around with 2 billion. If you use the banking system, right, you need, in order to make those huge transfers, you need to place it somewhere. And no one is going to take your money when the supply of money is so much greater than the demand for money, investment is so low relative to liquidity, that the price of money, the interest rate, keeps falling. That is a symptom that there is something spectacularly wrong with capitalism. So the way in which monopoly capitalism evolved after 1971, 72, created an economy that broke down in 2008. That economy was supported at the ideological level by neoliberalism, and now neoliberalism is being disputed simply because the economic model that it legitimized no longer works, not even for the rich.
Mm-hmm. I see, I mean...
That was a long answer, right?
But a satisfactory one, I have to say. My two cents is it has become a very successful ideology. I mean, who do we call a liberal? Like, it started with Thatcher, the cowboy, Reagan, Helmut Kohl, Özal in Turkey. mostly center-right conservative politicians back then. But then we also call Obama a neoliberal, like Clinton, Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton. You know, so it's like an umbrella term, like both right and the left at the same time, we call them neoliberals. And it has, in the end, it has become almost like an insult term, right? And that is the success of the bourgeois ideology.
That's why I don't use it.
I don't use it because it's not very healthy. Because if everybody is neoliberal, look, what matters is what you do, not what label you carry. So take Obama, okay? Obama was a great hope for those who suffered the collapse of the neoliberal order, of effectively financialization. So after the end of Bretton Woods in 1971, if you look at average earnings per person in the United States, in real terms, flat. Between 1973 and today, it's a bit lower now than it was. That's remarkable, because there's been such a blowout, an increase in wealth in the United States. Productivity, wealth, and yet the average worker per hour gets the same amount or even less today than in 1973. This is, you know, remarkable, right? It all went into profits. And the only way of keeping up with consumption in the United States was through financialization. That is, people bought a home with a mortgage, with a loan, and they made payments every month, and they hoped that the price of the house could go up, and it was going up. And then their wage was not going up. But because the house price was going up, they would get a credit card on the, you know, against the house to borrow money to buy iPods and iPhones and cars and whatever. And they were told, don't worry about it, because your house price is going up, at some point you can sell, that money is yours, it's like your savings. So you don't need higher wages, you have credit, you have loans on the basis of your house price that goes up. 2008, the house price went like this. They were thrown out, they lost their cars, and Obama comes in, right? As the great hope of those that were defrauded, fooled by Wall Street and the politicians working for Wall Street. And what does he do? First thing Obama does is he takes Tim Geithner and Larry Summers, the two finance ministers or finance treasury officials who in the 1990s had worked for Wall Street and released all the banks from all the constraints, and he appoints them again. Doesn't matter what you call him, he betrayed those who entrusted him with their vote. This is why we have Trump.
Then how do we fix it? I mean, we know you are on this side of the Atlantic proposing a Green New Deal for Europe, and Ocasio-Cortez on the other side proposing the American version. I mean, at first glance, it makes sense. I mean, the Green New Deal, it's hard to object. Like, I mean, who can object to a more environmental friendly, you know, production process or system? But the radical left's worry is that, just like you said a minute ago, the old New Deal was all about saving the capitalist system from the threat of, you know, Sovietization, Soviet Union socialism. That's why we had all these Keynesian, you know, policies in practice. So is it gonna be another restoration process, or like, is it gonna save capitalism one more time, or is it gonna save us from capitalism?
Fantastic question. Now look, to my left-wing friends who make this point and who say, come on, we shouldn't be trying to save capitalism, we should try to replace it. And who look at a crash like 2008 as a great thing. what I say to them is that we have a duty as humanists, as people who care in the end about human beings, beyond ideology, right? In the end, what matters is the life of people, so that people don't suffer. What we should be into is the minimization of human suffering. If you're a humanist, that's what you should care about. Firstly, I think it's wrong to say, okay, let some people suffer now because this is an investment. It will help. Their suffering now will bring about something much, much better later on. I don't think we have the right, the moral right, to sacrifice human beings that way. Secondly, it doesn't work. If you think of 1929, in 1929, capitalism collapsed. It collapsed. And what happened? Did socialism emerge? No. Fascism emerged. Nazism emerged. War happened. Millions died. Okay? So, the collapse of capitalism is not necessarily going to give rise to something better. It can give rise to something far worse. And it usually does. The rise of the ultra-right, of xenophobia, racism, today, is what happens when capitalism has a major shock that it had in 2008. 2008 was our generation's, your generation's 1929. And yet again, it's not progressives that are benefiting politically, it's again the same monsters that are benefiting politically. Alternative for Deutschland in Greece, the ultra-right in Germany, the ultra-right in Greece, Matteo Salvini in Italy, Farage and Johnson in Britain, Trump in the United States, Le Pen in France. These are the people who are doing well during the collapse, the crisis of capitalism. So, while our job is not to save capitalism for the capitalists, our job is to stabilize capitalism, stabilize it, and use its stabilization as the foundation on which to build an alternative to capitalism. I don't believe in year zero. I don't believe in, Pol Pot tried it in Cambodia, to destroy everything and start from zero, and you see what happened. It was, a dystopia. So, people out there, whether they're in Turkey, or in Greece, or in Germany, or in the United States, when a crisis happens, they privatize everything. People privatize everything. They privatize their pain. They privatize their fears. They privatize their hopes. They move away from society. They don't even talk to their neighbors. They stay at home and lick their wounds. They look after their children. They struggle to put food on the table. They lose the hope that the future will be better than the past. The moment lose hope that the future for their kids is going to be better than their past, it's very easy for a racist, opportunistic politician to stand up on a lectern like that and say, I'm going to make you proud again. I'm going to look after you. It's the foreigners who are coming to our country who are doing A, B, C. It is the foreigners outside our country who are treating our country with disrespect. We need a stronger army. We need a stronger wall to separate us from the others. We need to chase the enemy within. Give me power. I will look after you. I will give you a slightly higher wage, a pension. Mussolini did that. All the strongmen do this. So, we need to counter that. And how do we counter? What do we tell people? We tell people that, look, our problems here in Istanbul are remarkably similar to the problems that the others have in Thessaloniki or in Milano or in the north of England or in Ireland. They are remarkably similar. From the environment, we're all facing a catastrophe coming to us from climate change. This is going to affect your children. Your children are not going to be able to eat food, drink clean water. you know, breathe in exactly the same way that your neighbors won't be able to. But even if this is too far away in your mind, think of the problems that you have with low wages, with unemployment, because it's you have very low investment in good quality jobs. The same thing, I think, applies to the whole of the capitalist world. Can we solve this problem in Turkey if the Greeks and the Italians don't solve it? No. Like climate change. There will never be high investment in good quality jobs in Turkey if there is very low investment in the rest of Europe. So we have a common problem. Let's have a common solution. What could the common solution be? And this is where the Green New Deal comes. Because what you do is you give hope. Instead of building on despair and on anger, which is what the right does, to turn one person against another, one country against another, one people against another, you build on hope. And hope comes from realism. You say, look, if you take Turkey, Greece, Bulgaria, all the way to Ireland and Britain, you take these countries, and you count how much money is available in savings, in bank accounts, money that exists. And look at how much money we're investing in good quality jobs that are good for people and for the planet. You see this imbalance. The problem we have, do you realize that? Is we have too much money. I know that sounds strange. Not you and me, but as a society, as the West, as a capitalist world, including China, we have the largest amount of money ever in the history of humanity. Do you know that we have something like 33% of world income is being saved, a pile of cash. And if you compare it to how much money goes into investing in education, health, you know, clean energy, buildings, factories, it's there. This is huge imbalance. So that's not clever, is it? That's before you start talking about the distribution of money between rich and poor, the north and the south, and so on. So how about agreeing amongst each other that what we need to do is we need to energize the excess cash and put it into work to produce the clean energy that Turkey needs, Greece needs, Italy needs. And the best way of doing it is collaboratively. So, for instance, how about ending that stupidity, collective stupidity, of drilling holes in the seabed outside of Cyprus, of Greece, of Turkey, and actually having the Greek government and the Turkish government paying good money to the Americans and to the French to give us weapons so we can fight each other. To do what? In order to drill holes that we shouldn't want to drill, because oil and gas is useless now. It only destroys our atmosphere, it only destroys our waters, and the cost of producing electricity out of oil and gas is about 8 cents per kilowatt. Whereas from wind and solar, it's 2 cents. So they are making us, buy weapons to fight each other in order to get something we shouldn't want. Now that's the definition of collective stupidity. So let's not be stupid. Let's get organized, let's get together and find transnational solutions for our common problems. Solutions that you can tell to the person who is now struggling to put food on the table. This is the only way of providing your kids with good quality jobs and clean air. Do you want a good future for your children? Yeah, we need to collaborate. We're not going to do it with building walls and buying weapons. So that's the Green New Deal. It's a way of combining, of having a common plan for humanity, for our neighborhood at least, here in Europe, Southern Europe, the Near East, the Eastern Mediterranean, the whole thing, a common plan and common instruments. Let's combine the forces of the Central Bank of Turkey with the Central Bank of Europe, the Central Bank of England, our investment banks, as part of one plan to create better jobs, higher income, and reduce tensions in the vicinity, in the region. Once we start doing that, now speaking as a leftist who does not believe that capitalism has a future, once we've stabilized capitalism, Then we can start having the second conversation. What comes after capitalism? What will post-capitalism look like? Because post-capitalism is going to happen. The idea of having the big corporation with the big headquarters and the CEOs and the managers and then the middle managers and thousands of workers underneath, that's finished. Technology is killing this. Because now with the internet, artificial intelligence, 3D printers, you'll see cars will be produced en masse, especially electric cars, without Volkswagen, without General Motors, because it will be so easy for, 20 smart students from Istanbul, in a collaboration over the internet with some people in San Francisco, to design a car and then press a button and then it gets printed in some 3D printer in Tunisia, right? And if you have that, why do you need Volkswagen? So these large corporations are going to die because, not because of the left, not because of the revolution. They will die by the hand of the technologies that they produce. But what happens after that? How do we organize life? Who pays taxes? Who doesn't pay taxes? Who owns the robots? Who owns the 3D printers? Because if they're owned by the oligarchy, then we're in serious trouble. They will not, the robots will not be able to purchase. They will not want to purchase the cars that they produce. So who is going to have the money to buy the cars? The whole system is in tatters unless we have a democratized economy. But that's the second step after the Green New Deal. First, you stabilize capitalism on behalf of the many and across borders, and then we plan together what kind of institutions, what kind of corporate law we want.
It makes sense. I mean, I know you're also against that robot tax, just you said, and how do you want to plan to finance this if you're not going to tax the robots?
Well, that's because Bill Gates came out with this idea. I mean, Bill Gates is one of these people who is worried because he's sitting on a pile of money, right? And he looks at all the rest of humanity and says, my God, these people are sinking deeper and deeper and deeper into a bad life. So, either they will kill me or I will not be able, I will go to hell when I die. That's what he thinks. So he's trying to think of solutions. The one solution he doesn't think of is to change capitalism. But anyway, so he came up with this idea of, because robots are replacing human beings, human beings will have no jobs, somebody will have to look after the human beings that have no jobs. So Bill Gates came up with the idea of taxing the robots that are replacing the human beings. Sounds good, but it's of course very silly. Because how do you define a robot? What is a robot? Is this a robot? No. But at the same time, if you have a robot that actually looks like a robot, has two hands, two legs, and actually does things like, assembles cars, okay? How do you measure the value that that robot is producing in relation to the computer system driving the robot? So do you tax the mechanical robot but not the computer that is driving it? How do you do that? It cannot be done. It's silly. It's a stupid idea. Forget it. So DiEM25's suggestion, proposal, instead of a robot tax, is very simple. But you have to have a left-wing background to understand where it comes from. You see, people like Bill Gates and supporters of standard capitalist doctrine believe that labor is one contributor to production and its reward is the wage. Capital is another contributor to production, machinery, and its reward is profit. Rubbish. This is not how it happens. Capital is produced by labor. It is human beings that produce the machines. And this has a touch screen, right? It's got a GPS system. It's got a Wi-Fi system. It's got a microprocessor. Everything I just mentioned was produced by the state. Everything. Yeah? Wi-Fi was produced by a state-run research company in Australia, CSIRO. Wi-Fi, the microcomputer, were all devised by state research projects in the United States. The touchscreen, again, by some public institution. So the myth is that wealth is produced individually by the private sector, and that the state comes and taxes it. Right? So the state is the bad guy that comes and takes money away from the privateers that produce things. Right? The collective comes and sucks value out of individual. That's not how the world works. We all produce value together, collectively. But then some very smart and powerful privateers tax it, and they become the oligarchs. So if we are right that, you know, anything from the steam engine, okay, it was James Watt that invented it, but he was standing on the shoulders of thousands, if not millions, of thinkers, inventors, physicists, engineers to produce that. Similarly, today, every time you go into your search engine, Google, and you search for something, you add to the capital of Google. When you carry your phone with you, when you're driving here in Istanbul, then Google Maps knows how many people are on every street, so it makes it red. So the app becomes more useful to you because you know where it is congested. So people out there are contributing to the capital stock of Google. In other words, we are producing capital collectively. But it's only Google that gets the profits. So what we are proposing is something very simple. To begin with, every company that operates in Turkey should contribute the equivalent of 10% of its shares to a welfare fund. We could make it collective, we could make it pan-European, we could make it global. And that fund has shares in it, it collects dividends, and the dividends are then divided, little bits of money, to every citizen, to everyone who uses or doesn't use Google services. So imagine a situation where you've got a fund where all the large corporations put 10% of their shares in, and then this fund distributes money to every bank account of every human being. And at first, the money that trickles down to each one of us is going to be very little, very little. But the more production is automated, the more robots are utilized, the higher the revenues and the dividends of these companies, the more money goes to the people. And if we start at 10%, we could push it to 20%, 30%. And think about it, the limit is 100%. That's communism without a state. Communism without communists. Star Trek. We all own the machinery works for all of us, and we can all sit around here and have philosophical discussions.
Awesome. Maybe move towards politics, European Union.
That wasn't politics. Okay.
No, but actual politics.
Okay.
I mean, a monetary union without a proper fiscal union was destined to fail, right? I mean, that was the main issue with this European Union project. I mean, think about the American state, like state of California, Texas, South Dakota, Florida, Illinois. If one of those states experiences a regional, local economic downturn, what happens is the federal government helps that specific state, basically financed or subsidized by the other states. And that does not become an issue or problem in the United States because it's a federal, you know, government, United States of America. But that's not what we had in the European Union. And the richer nations like France, Germany seem to be reluctant to form a financial and fiscal unity. How do you think we can solve this problem for the future of Europe?
Well, at least, you know, you are lucky not to be in the Eurozone. Okay? If you were in the Eurozone, you'd be living in a concentration camp now, like we do in Greece. Okay, you have your own political problems here in Turkey, but at least you are sovereign. If you don't like the government you have, you can have another one. And it's for you people to decide. And to act, well, no, you can rebel. Okay? But you were not going to have a situation where you get a telephone call from Frankfurt saying, if you elect this person and you don't cut down pensions to these people, we'll shut down your banks tomorrow morning. Yeah, that's a very important freedom that you have in this country, and don't underestimate it. But look, don't forget about the United States, too far away, yeah. And too different and too weird. Take Turkey, since we're here. Yeah. Now, you don't have a federation, but you have a country that is very diverse. Mm-hmm. Istanbul is very different to Anatolia, in terms of its economy, even culture, mm-hmm. to a large extent. Okay? But you have a common polity. So, you know, people get a pension, it's not that large. They get a little bit of benefits here and there. They have, you know, roads that are being built by the Turkish government in Anatolia as well as in Istanbul, right? So when you have a crisis, and you often have crisis here, the crisis affects different places differently. It's never homogeneous. So in the poorer areas, okay, unemployment goes up faster, income falls faster than it does in Istanbul. But because you have a single government, right, the pension is maintained mm-hmm. in Anatolia, even though income may have fallen faster than it has fallen in Istanbul. So effectively what you have is an automatic mechanism. Nobody decides at the moment, let's help Anatolia. What happens is, because the moment incomes in Anatolia fall faster than in Istanbul, but pensions are the same, money goes from Istanbul to Anatolia. So there is an automated system of solidarity within a country, whether the country is Turkey, Germany, Greece, whatever. In the Eurozone, we created a common area without that. And moreover, the worst part of it is that we have different banking systems. We had a Greek banking system and a German banking system and, you know, an Italian banking system. And the central bank that we created, the European Central Bank, was not allowed to save them during bad periods. Here, you may complain that the government is far more interested in saving the banks than saving the people. And you're right to complain about that. But you know, at least they can do it. The central bank prints a bit of money and gives it to the bankers, which is, we can criticize it from a distributional perspective. But what happened in Greece, in Italy, is pathetic. Because the central bank cannot print money to give to the banks. When the bankers have losses, they come to the people and they cut their pensions to give to the bankers. So, you know, it's a system designed, as if designed by the Satan, in order to create as much suffering as possible. That's what the Eurozone is. It's a cretinous design. And the result is that in Europe, you know, which is extremely rich, is in a crisis which is totally unnecessary. But the reason why it's not being fixed is because, allow me to be blunt on this. At the moment, if you are the German Chancellor, you decide everything. Everything. The French President, the Italian Prime Minister, the Greek Prime Minister, they will never speak up to you. Because they know that with one of your words, you can destroy them. You can destroy them. You know, if a word comes from the German Chancellery that, oh, I don't think that the French banking system is sustainable, suddenly the French banks collapse. So it's inordinate power. If a French President says this about the German banks, nothing will happen. Because they know that the German finance ministry is strong enough to support Deutsche Bank, even though Deutsche Bank is bankrupt. Mm-hmm. If we had a federation, which is the only way of moving forward. If you have common money, you have to have a common democracy. But if you had a federation, what percentage of the federal government would be elected by German votes? 23%. So suddenly they would be in a minority. That's why we're not having a federation. That's why we have the continuation of this travesty of a common currency, but not a common government. So this is exactly the opposite of democracy. And the worst thing is that those who suffer are not just the Greeks and the Italians, it's half of the Germans. Because if you are at the lower 50% of the German population today, right, you pay a huge price for the exorbitant power of Angela Merkel and the German ruling class. Because for the last 20 years, living standards in Germany are falling rapidly for the lower 50%, which is a scandal if you think that Germany now has more money than ever. And half of the population are finding harder and harder and harder to make ends meet. That's what explains the rise of racism in Germany. Because half of the population are suffering, okay, when all around them there is wealth. So it's one thing to be in Anatolia or in the Peloponnese in Greece. You know, you're poor amongst poor people. It's not good. But it's worse if you're poor amongst very rich people. And that's the situation in Berlin. That's the situation in Leipzig. That's the situation in Aachen, in Munich. So it's, you know, this is why DiEM25, our movement, is very strong in Germany. It is, you know, we are working everywhere because we are the only ones who are not allowing the narrative of the Germans against the Greeks, the North against the South, to dominate. This is an argument for rationality, for humanism, for solidarity with the German workers, solidarity with the Greek pensioners, solidarity with everyone independently of nationality on the basis of rationality.
I totally agree with you. Hopefully we will also, as Turkey, be part of that, you know, European solidarity sometime soon.
We already are. Yeah. Because DiEM25, the Democracy in Europe movement that I represent, and this is, you know, why I'm here, because with members of DiEM25 here in Turkey, DiEM25 does not recognize borders. We don't believe that Europe ends where the EU ends. So for us, Turkey is part of Europe. We would allow, you know, even go so far as to say that parts of Northern Africa are part of Europe, if they feel that they are. We believe in self-determination. If you feel European, you're European. And if you feel European, you are European, you can be a member of DiEM25. So setting up DiEM25 Turkey, and this is why some of us are here, to talk to our colleagues here in Turkey to set it up. Yeah. You're already part of the European project, to the extent that DiEM25 is about the European project. Whether Serbia or Turkey are in the EU or not in the EU is irrelevant to us. We are here as human beings, as comrades, as colleagues, fighting for a Europe that knows no borders, and the only thing that it recognizes is the importance of minimizing human suffering and not wasting stupidly fantastic opportunities for shared prosperity.
All right, maybe one last topic, which is the hottest topic, the UK elections. I mean, most of us, I bet, wondering your opinion here. But I mean, my two cents is, I feel like with Johnson's win, which is very disappointing for us, and you supported, DiEM25 supported Corbyn over there. But what I feel like is that like almost all the countries are becoming more and more like Turkey. as if I feel like they started their own period of Turkey's last 17 years. But like looking at the other countries, it's like, I mean, Johnson, Trump, Bolsonaro, Orban, Macron, Erdogan, it's like
Greece,
yeah. All the countries are electing the same person, like it's almost. It's like a monopolistic competition with slight product differentiation there.
It's actually worse than that. It's actually worse than that.
How so?
Well, take France. They did not elect somebody like that. They elect Emmanuel Macron. Macron, I know him personally. He's a nice man. I mean, genuinely, if you meet him, at least before he became president, he was quite sweet and, you know, and open-minded, and we agreed on a lot of things. But his election only took place because of Le Pen, you know, of the Orban of France.
The France,
yeah, or the Salvini of France. So this is the great paradox. I know Emmanuel personally. I know he hates Le Pen personally, and he's got every right to. She's despicable. She's racist. You know, she hates the Turks, the Greeks. I think she hates herself, you know, being misanthropic, she has to hate herself. But in the end, the two are functioning like partners. They don't like each other. They don't think of themselves as partners, but they work as partners. Because think about it. Le Pen gets stronger the more Macron implements neoliberal policies in France. So, you know, if she was smart, she should have a little picture of him next to her bedside and pray to him every night, thank you President Macron for doing everything you're doing because I'm getting stronger. And Macron should have a little icon of Le Pen on his bedside because he's only president because of her. He would never have been elected if it wasn't for the threat of Le Pen. So the two, even though they are appearing as antagonists, okay, even if the differentiation, the product differentiation is great, in the end, they are working towards an authoritarian government, because the liberal establishment is supremely authoritarian. Think of what they did when I was in government. They came to us and said, they came to me personally and said behind closed doors that I was completely right. The policies of austerity in Greece were terrible. They would lead to them getting less money back from us than if they agreed with my proposals. But, Yanis, that's Christine Lagarde saying this to me, we can't go back because we have committed ourselves to this policy and you have to wear it. And so they tell me I'm right. And what do they do when I insist that we shouldn't do what they say? They close down the banks. They close down the banks. And the next day, they slash the lowest of the low pensions. They take our airports and give them to a German company for zero money. Zero. 1.2 billion, they will tell you, in theory. But that 1.2 billion came from the Greek government, from the Greek people. So it's like I'm coming to your house. I say, this is a nice house. I want it. How much do you want? You say to me, you know, whatever it is. And you say, okay, I said to you, you'll give me your house and you'll give me the money to buy it. That's authoritarianism. That's another form of authoritarianism, right? So that's the first thing to remember. Okay, now going to break to the case of Brexit. A connection with Turkey. Remember the connection with Turkey? June 2016, when Brexit won the referendum, Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage were photographed in front of a bus. And the bus had a big poster in front of it. And there was a long line queue of people with their bags. Okay? And there was this symbolic border of Britain, of the United Kingdom, and it said, the Turks are coming. Do you remember that? Yeah. So this weaponized xenophobia, weaponized racism, is part of Brexit. The tragedy is that Brexit won because good socialists voted for it. Now, how is this possible? I'll tell you how it's possible. I campaigned against Brexit in Britain back then, together with Jeremy Corbyn, John McDonnell, our comrades from the Labour Party who lost now. We campaigned against Brexit. And I would go to meetings like this, in the north of England. Now, those were areas that Margaret Thatcher and neoliberalism had destroyed. They had closed down the factories in which they worked for one reason, to destroy the trades union that was organizing there. Not because the factory was not producing good things or that it was not profitable. Some were not. But they closed profitable ones as well, because it was the only way of destroying the power of the organized working class. So those people were destroyed in the 1980s. Then Labour comes with Tony Blair adopting the same neoliberal policies and just giving them a little bit more money, you know, handouts. So this is very humiliating. You know, people want jobs. People want dignity. To be given a little bit more money to live in a cesspool of hopelessness, yeah, is like adding insult to their injury. So they hated the Labour Party as well, right? And they could see that meanwhile, in the south of England, you know, Greeks and Turks, richer Greeks, Portuguese, Italians, were all there having jobs that were funded effectively through the banks, the City of London. And especially after 2008, with the Bank of England printing a lot of money and giving to the corporations, giving to the banks. So they look at the, you know, they say, what happened to us up here? This globalization, which to them appeared part and parcel of the European Union, which at the same time was saying to London governments, you're not allowed to subsidize industries in the north, because this is against common market regulations and anti-dumping and all that. Eh? Suddenly, in their mind, the European Union is a symbol of a new social order that treats them like rats, like pigs, whose value has collapsed. Not even pigs with value. Okay? And they ask themselves the same question that people in the United States ask when they voted for Donald Trump. How do I annoy these elites? How do we annoy them? They insult us. How do we upset them? By stopping them from traveling to Europe freely. By stopping them from having these cozy relationships with Brussels. So we are going to vote. And to boot, when I was in Doncaster and Leeds and those places in the north, they say to me, look, Yanis, I was saying to them, look, the European Union is very anti-democratic. I know that in my bones. I experienced the authoritarianism with Christine Lagarde, with Schäuble, with Merkel. But what I'm saying to you is, the solution is not for you to leave. The solution is for you to stay in order for us to work together transnationally in order to change the European Union, in order to transform it so that it works for the many, not for the few. Those are our slogans. And you know what they said to me? No. Let me tell you why. I'm telling you no, they would say to me. Because if Brexit does not win in the referendum, you are not going to be the Prime Minister, our Prime Minister. Jeremy Corbyn is not going to be our Prime Minister. It was David Cameron back then. And he's going to consider this as a victory for him. They are going to consider it as a victory for all those people who treated us like rubbish, like pigs, and who, in the end, treated you, meaning me, your government, the Syriza government, with authoritarianism. So no, I agree with you. If you were the Prime Minister of Greece, and Jeremy Corbyn was the Prime Minister of Britain, we would vote to stay in the EU. This is a very powerful argument, I have to admit to you. I couldn't argue against them. So, what lost the election a few days ago in Britain was not Jeremy Corbyn. It was not the Labour Party manifesto. It was not a left-wing agenda that lost. What lost, the people who actually lost, but they don't care, are the Blairites, the liberal establishment within the Labour Party, that constantly undermined the left-wing agenda of Jeremy Corbyn, who constantly tried to undermine Jeremy Corbyn, who are much more interested in overthrowing Jeremy Corbyn within the Labour Party than Brexit. Just like, you know, Hillary Clinton and the Democratic establishment in the United States prefer Trump to win than Bernie Sanders to win. And they will work against a Sanders victory, even if it means that Satan will win. Huh? These are the people who are, you see, the bad people are united. The conservatives, the Brexiteers, the racists were totally united on last Thursday. It was our side of politics that was divided, and it was the establishment bourgeois part of the labor movement that did everything it could to ensure that the Labour Party would not win.
Thank you, Yanis. I think our time is almost over here. Maybe let's not your time. So before we move on to the Q&A session, let's give him a big applause.
Can I say one thing?
Sure.
I know that I'm the guest here, right? It's your show. I'm the guest. But I'd like to propose one rule for the Q&A that DiEM25 is very strict on. Mm-hmm. Before any man speaks, a woman must speak.
Awesome.
Do you want to adopt it?
Of course. So you got it.
So if no woman wants to speak, we go home. Mm-hmm.
But there will be another rule, which is 30 seconds rule. So keep your questions as brief as possible so that we can take more men and women questions.
Okay, we need a woman.
First.
There she is.
Hi, what makes you think that technology companies who do robotization want to give you a percentage of their shares? You just said, you told about a system where these robotization companies would give a percentage of their companies to a fund. What makes you think that owners of these companies would want to give it, and how is that different from the normal state system where we pay the taxes to the state?
Okay, well, that's a fantastic question.
Firstly,
they will not want to. But so what? They don't want to pay tax anyway. That doesn't mean we don't have taxation. They manage to avoid it. But it's really very simple. You legislate. You say, if you want to operate in this country, you need to take a certain amount of shares and put it here. You don't do it, you don't operate in this country. Go home. And I can assure you that they will much rather do that. All they will do is, remember, they will issue a few more shares. Dilute the existing shareholders. They do this every day anyway. And put it there. And how does it differ to taxation? I'll tell you how it differs to taxation. It differs crucially. Taxation, right, is a transfer. So, you know, the state comes to me and taxes me, so it takes some money from me and gives it to a pensioner, or gives it to a banker, or gives it, you know, to a builder of a road. That is a transfer. Okay? Your wage is not transfer. It's no transfer. When you work, you get what you deserve, what you've earned, what you've grabbed by the power of your labor. Right? When you get a dividend from a share you have, let's say you started a company with a friend and you get a share of the profits, this is your just reward. It is your income from your entrepreneurial activity. So if you have shares of Google that are placed inside an international wealth fund, right? The money that goes in there and then is distributed to people is not a transfer. It is not money that is taken away from Google. Google is not being taxed. What happens is we have a new social contract where we're saying that, you know what? Part of your capital has been produced by the people of Turkey. Every time we use your services, we add not to your income, to your capital. The fact that you have a map of Turkey in there and you know where each one of us is part of your capital. So the people of Turkey deserve an income that is a return to the capital they contribute to your company. So it's not a transfer. So this is very important, you know, because this is the difference between a universal basic income and a universal basic dividend. You are familiar with the proposals for universal basic income, that everybody should have a certain amount of money that the state pays them from taxation. Well, the problem with the universal basic income, one of the problems, is that a lot of working class people will be very upset. They say, hang on a second, I wake up at 6 in the morning, I work for 12 hours, I make an income, it gets taxed, and then it's given to somebody who sits around doing nothing all day. But the universal basic dividend is different. Because this person, that person, even the person that doesn't work, uses Google and contributes to the social capital, to the actual capital of Google. So everybody has the right to an equal share of it. So that's ideologically very important and technically quite separate. I can't hear you.
How will you ensure that they will not try to control the company through those stocks?
You mean the social welfare fund?
Yeah.
Well, there can be shares that don't have voting rights. Technically, it's really very simple.
Okay, let's...
Non-voting shares.
Let's take... Professor...
We need to go to the next show. Let's talk about this outside. I think the rest are bored.
Before your question, I have to say that you can also ask questions in Turkish if you like. We have a two-way translation here. So please.
Professor Varoufakis, welcome home. I have one question. When Syriza came to power, many people believed that there will be an end-to-end austerity and the Syriza will not yield to the pressures of the IMF and the financial enterprises. As an economist, in your words, how did you fare, what will be your assessment in Greece pulling out of Eurozone, going into a free floating drachmi, or call it new drachmi? What will be the adjustment costs of that route versus going with the IMF program and austerity? How would you compare the likely costs of the alternatives?
Okay, let me begin by saying first that I want to give you two answers. The first one is, it's very difficult to compute because, you know, let's face it, as, you know, economists, we know that if you have a sample of zero, it's very difficult to make predictions. And what I mean by that is that no country has ever left the euro. So we don't have evidence. I have done an econometric study. And imperfect, but not useless. My estimation, and I'll give you a succinct answer, is that if we had left back then, in the summer of 2015, created our own currency, we would have a serious drop of GDP between 8 and 11%. But within 18 months, we would have recovered all of it. And after that, we would be having a growth rate between 6 and 7%. So in that sense, I was ready to go for it. And the delicious irony is that if we were ready to go for it, if my prime minister was ready to go for it, I was, if he was too, then we wouldn't have to go for it, because they would come begging for an agreement that does not bring us out of the euro and a debt restructure within the euro. Why? Because Grexit would have cost the European Union 1 trillion euros. It would have cost them 1 trillion euros, at least. They wouldn't be able to sustain it. So if we were ready to do it, then we wouldn't have to do it.
So the rule, a woman must speak.
Woman.
Yeah.
We have
over there.
You have told us a little bit about production functions, capital labor or something like that, and you thought that they are bullshit. Do you have, my question is so clear and maybe the answer could be a little bit long. Do you have any suggestion for the people who are teaching economics in universities?
Huh. Well, regarding that, I think you should, it's a moral duty for economics professors to teach the capital controversies. You're familiar with the capital controversies. That's very important because it was a very useful, very interesting debate between two schools of economists, one in Cambridge, England, and the other one in Cambridge, Massachusetts, where they discussed the nature of capital and the reward of capital. And the dominant way of thinking lost the argument. You know, the
Samuelson.
Yes, Samuelson and the neoclassical production function approach lost the argument. For those of you who are not economists, the standard way of looking at things is that capital is like labor, it's like electricity, it's like, you know, water. You can measure it, and then you measure the satisfaction that it gives you, or how useful it is, its utility. And then its reward, which is the rate of profit, is proportional or determined by the degree of utility of contribution that it makes. Like, you know, when you drink water, the satisfaction you get, right? So you use capital, you get more productivity, you measure how much capital goes in, you measure how much satisfaction goes out, production, whatever, and that is a relationship between profit and capital. And Cambridge, Britain, primarily, you know, John Robinson and Piero Sraffa and those wonderful people back then, challenged the notion of capital as measurable. They said, I'm sorry, you cannot do that. You cannot determine the profit rate after measuring capital and looking at the marginal productivity of the last sip of, you know, the last morsel of capital, the marginal contribution to the world. And you can't do that because it's very simple. Capital, unlike water, is not homogeneous. So you have new tractors and you have old tractors. You just can't add them together. You have tractors and you have computers. You have hammers and you have microchips. What is capital? How do you, what's the quantity of capital? You can not only estimate the value of capital, but the total value of capital. You say a tractor costs this much, plus you have two computers, each one of them is so much. So you add their value. But to do that, you need to have their prices. But to have their prices, so if you need the prices to measure it, you cannot determine the price of capital or the profit. It's like a cat chasing its tail. So we won the argument. And, you know, Samuelson and the rest agreed, conceded that we won the argument. And what happened? After all these people died? Nothing. We keep teaching the wrong stuff as if it is the right stuff. So this is a...
Not in this school.
Very good. So teach the capital controversies and teach that labor and capital is not like potatoes. This is important.
I have to say that I am teaching history of economic thought, and I always teach the Cambridge capital controversy to my students, and some of them are here anyway. Please.
Hi, I would like to ask you a question about the overthrow of Gaddafi. You know, the French played a very important role, Sarkozy, the French planes, etc. Now, there are allegations that this was due to Gaddafi's effort to set up some African Monetary Union, and that this Monetary Union, African Monetary Union, would harm, say, the preponderance of the Franc-African system. Would you like to comment on this?
Well, I can't really comment on something I don't know. So the downfall of Gaddafi was accomplished by several forces, Western forces, not working with one another, usually working in opposition to one another. The Italians played a role, the British played a role, the Americans, of course, played a role, the French played a role. What I find appalling is that while on the one hand I have no sympathy for Gaddafi, none whatsoever, personally, the result, just like the invasion of Iraq after Saddam Hussein, was a quagmire, was a total human catastrophe. And just one thing since that came to mind, that it's not relevant to your question, but I remember watching a video of Hillary Clinton watching the video of Gaddafi being disemboweled and cheering, cheering. You know, if I were watching a video of Hitler being disemboweled, I would do this and I would be upset. Not that because I have sympathy for Hitler, but because I'm a human being. I cannot cheer while watching any human being, however horrible they might be, being disemboweled and having their genitals cut off. So I thought, when I saw Hillary celebrating, I thought, oh my God, I do not want her to be the president of the United States.
No, no, a woman next, and then...
Thank you. And my question is about the welfare fund again, but the distribution side of it. So you said if it's going to be like a universal basic dividend, it will tackle the issues of the universal basic income. But then do you think it can still tackle the problem of citizenship versus residency? Because, I mean, with the current migration inflows, it can be also problematic who has the right to receive that sort of funding, because you said it might also be on basis of usage, not necessarily like employment, etc. So what do you think on that?
Well, ideally it should be a global fund going to every human being. That solves the problem, but of course it's, you know, very lofty. So how do you implement it? If you do it at a nation state base, well, that is a political discussion. DiEM25, our movement, is very clear on this. We don't recognize any difference between residents and citizens. That's a political decision, it's a moral decision. I'm sure that other political formations will have different views. I think we need to embed this discussion in the broader discussion of citizenship, of you know, a post-Westphalian understanding of the state. I think that the old notion of one culture, one language, one religion, one parliament, one money, one citizenship is gone, and we need to move well beyond that.
Galiba sıra bana geldi. 30 saniyede çok soru sorma rekorunu zorlayacağım. Birincisi, sadece konuşmanızın 65. dakikasında örgütlükçe sınıfından bahsettiniz. Oysa ona gelene kadar bütün kavramların hepsini müteaddit defalar tekrar ettiniz. Alet kutunuzda sınıf kavramı olmadan dünyayı bugün anlayabilmek ve çözümleyebilmek mümkün mü? Benim hocam, sizin yurttaşınız Kostas Vergopoulos bana her iktisatçının alet kutusundaki ilk argüman sınıf kavramıdır diye 8. Paris Üniversitesi'nde öğretmişti. Ben hala onun gibi düşünüyorum. İki, anlattığınız faşizm tehdidi, dünya kriziyle bağıntılı faşizm tehdidi imkanları reddediyor. Kriz aynı zamanda imkan. Evet, faşizm bir tehdit. Ama faşizmi Bertolt Brecht gibi ya da Mario Machuetti gibi kapitalizme mündemiç, kapitalizme dahil bir şey olarak düşünmek daha makul değil mi? Mario Machuetti liberalizm özüne indirgenmiş faşizm diye öğretmişti bana 8. Paris Üniversitesi'nde. O mu yanılıyor bilmiyorum. Ve nihayet üçüncüsü, onarılabilir bir kapitalizmden bahsettiniz. Onarmaktan bahsettiniz. Rakamları seviyor musunuz? Ben de rakamları çok severim. Allah aşkına bana biraz rakam verin. Neyi onaracaksınız? Nasıl onaracaksınız? Şu rakamları bana anlatın. Ben buradan ikna olup çıkmak istiyorum. Teşekkür ederim. 30 saniyeyi geçmedim.
Okay. The history of humanity is the history of class war. Karl Marx. I live and I will die on the basis of that reality. So class, for me, is utterly central to everything. To everything. But at the same time, it's not everything. It is central to everything, but it is not everything. As Marx himself taught us, right? The question is, when you have, take for instance my country, right? Take Greece. In 2008, the global financial collapse resulted in a unique collapse. Not just a crisis, a collapse. Crisis is not the same thing as collapse. In other words, to put it differently, you know, companies left Greece. All the big companies left Greece. You had a situation where the ones that continued to operate, the capitalist didn't know whether he would be bankrupt tomorrow or in 3 days. He owed money everywhere, and he was struggling not to close down the business, usually small business to medium. And you had a remarkable degree of solidarity for the first time between the worker and the capitalist. The worker was not getting paid, the capitalist could not pay him or her. They were both finding it impossible to sleep at night because of the angst. So when capitalism reaches this level of collapse, class ceases to be the most pertinent issue. What becomes the most pertinent issue at the moment is that everybody is bankrupt. You have a quadruple bankruptcy. A bankrupt state, bankrupt banks, bankrupt families, and bankrupt capitalists. You had a situation where even land ownership was a curse, because there were land taxes, no rents, people couldn't rent their property out, but they had to pay taxes. So there was a joke that, you know, once upon a time, the father would threaten the children, if you're not good, I'm going to cut you out of my will, so you won't take my property. And nowadays, with the collapse, it changed to, if you're not good, I'm going to write everything in your name. So suddenly class is no longer the axis around which social conflict happens. So it was at that point that it was, you know, I even had a lot of support from neoliberals who agreed with me in attacking the bailouts of the Troika and of Brussels and of Frankfurt. Because from their perspective, those bailouts were a way of pushing private costs onto the state. So a neoliberal doesn't like that, if they're genuine neoliberals. Okay. Now the question is, the question for the left regarding the class war, because we are experiencing a class war, the right are fantastic at fighting the class war. Look at Britain. It's what I mentioned about, you know, Tariq Ali earlier on. The right, they had their difference of opinion between those in favor of the European Union and against. In the end, they stuck together and they won. It is the left that always is divided. So in this class warfare, what is the best way of taking the side of the working class? Is it to suggest that we get out of the European Union if we are in Britain or in Greece? Is it to propose checks around our borders? Or alternatively, to propose freedom of movement? Because the left, you know, look, I mean, you mentioned, I mean, by the way, I was a friend of Kostas Vergopoulos, right? In France, I had lots of disagreements with Jean-Luc Mélenchon, whose argument was that foreigners, and he meant, you know, Polish workers, Turkish workers, come into France, they increase the labor supply and they push the wages down. For me, that is an appalling analysis. This is wrong, it's not true, it never happens. And secondly, it is totally at odds with class analysis, with internationalism, with Marx. So these are the issues. I didn't understand your question about, you asked me to tell you what the cost of repairing is. Maybe it's the translation, but can you ask it again?
Ben kapitalizmin sürdürülemez olduğunu düşünüyorum. Siz sürdürülebilir ve onarılabilir olduğunu düşünüyorsanız, tekrarlayayım mı? Sungur, tamam mı? Siz kapitalizmin onarılabilir olduğunu düşünüyorsunuz. Beni ikna edebilmek için Allah aşkına bana birkaç rakam verin. Mesela ben size her bir saniyede bir çocuğun açlıktan öldüğünü bu dünyada söylerim. Bunun adı sürdürülemez kapitalizmdir derim. Galiba sizinle anlaşırız. Anlaşırsak onarılacak geriye ne kaldı? Yıkmaktan başka.
We don't disagree. I never said that it can be repaired. Capitalism can never be civilized. Capitalism can never be repaired. I talked about stabilization. Stabilization. Right? Stabilization. And what I mean by that is this. Look. When you've got a massive crisis like in 2008, like in 1929, like in 2010 in Greece, right? And you allow capitalism just to fall on its face very quickly, you do not stabilize it, what happens is not only are children dying as they are, we have thousands and thousands of children dying of austerity in Britain. In Britain, 40,000 children died because of austerity in the last 8 years. But what you have is a spike, an acceleration of the suffering, of the human suffering. And that acceleration is not conducive to left-wing politics, to progressive politics. Instead, it fuels the fascists, the Brexiteers, the Farages. So I'm not arguing in favor of fixing capitalism, I mean arguing in favor of stabilizing it, and I will give you some numbers about that, so that we can then have the opportunity, the space, to plan the transcendence of capitalism with the people who would not be dead, let me put it this way, or who will not fall into the embrace of the fascists. Some numbers. In Europe today, we have something that Karl Marx never expected. If you read Das Kapital, Volume 1, Volume 2, Volume 3, you will never see the number that I'm going to mention now. In the European Union, in the Eurozone only, we have 2.1 trillion euros of uninvested money that is not being invested, sitting there doing nothing. If you read Capital, one of the fundamental assumptions of Marx is that capitalists take the money that is available, the surplus, and they invest it in order to increase their capital accumulation. 2.1 trillion, this means that capitalism is broken in a way that even Marx is not predicting. And this 2.1 trillion is the reason why we have this exponential acceleration of the suffering. So, we will not fix capitalism, but if you take that 2 trillion and, like Roosevelt did in 1933, and he reduced poverty very quickly, he reduced hunger very quickly, and he stabilized the American economy, and therefore prevented the rise of Nazism in the United States. This is what we need to do, not because suddenly capitalism will become sustainable, but to buy us time in order to think of the ways in which we can move to post-capitalism, call it socialism, whatever you want. Yeah? A change in the property rights over the means of production. That is the only cure. But to have the luxury of reaching the stage when you can have that cure, you need stabilization, not repairing.
Next, a woman, please.
Or there.
No, this one.
My question is about the enlargement of the Eurozone. So currently, if I'm not mistaken, there are 19 EU countries in the Eurozone. and why it's not growing. Countries like Sweden, why do they not want to join? Why Eurozone isn't attractive? And if not Sweden, what other countries do you think would join next?
Well, the answer is very simple. They're not stupid. Why would you want to join the Eurozone? Why? It's like saying, you know, why don't you take a gun and shoot your foot? Would you want to shoot your foot?
No. Oh. And then another short question. All EU leaders are now talking about let's complete the monetary union for the next big crisis. But they do nothing. So, and how do you actually prepare for a crisis anyway? What do you think on that?
Well, this is a very interesting question. It's in political philosophy, right? One of the most interesting notions, concepts, is that of a clash between the collective interest and the private interest. You know, the failure of collective decision making. This is a typical case of, you know, the Eurozone is a typical case. There is no doubt that we need a fiscal union and a political union, because otherwise the system is going to constantly produce crises that it cannot deal with. It's like taking the shock absorbers out of your car and driving it into a pothole. So why don't they fix it? They all know it needs to be fixed. They all, you know, behind closed doors, I can assure you of that, because I've talked to one, everybody agrees that we need a fiscal union and a political union. But why don't they do it? Because while they understand that this is in our collective interest, each one of them has an incentive as politicians not to propose it or to impede it. This is, it's like a prisoner's dilemma problem. So we need a transformation of politics. And this is what we're trying to do with DiEM25 in order to affect that. But to help you understand it, let me give you an example. Back in 2012, right? Before I became famous for all the wrong reasons with the ministry. I was in Berlin and I was giving a speech in Berlin on exactly that. How can we create shock absorbers in the Eurozone to prevent, to absorb the shocks of the crisis and as a first step towards the federation that we need? So the proposal was really very technical of things we could do within the regulations, within the rules of the game, in order to solve the crisis. And it involved the European Investment Bank issuing lots of bonds to create investment opportunities and funding in Italy, in Greece, but also in Germany. This European Central Bank backing those, to have the European Central Bank divide the debt of each Eurozone member state into the good part of the debt and the bad part of the debt, and help with the good part of the debt by issuing its own bonds. Technical things, but things that would have worked. Yeah? And in the audience, there was a certain gentleman whose name I shan't mention. He was the top economic advisor of Angela Merkel. So he came up to speak to me, and I thought, oh my God, he's going to attack me now. And to my great astonishment, he said, I agree with you. These are good proposals. I thought to myself, my God. And so I said, okay, so you will recommend them to the chancellor, won't you? He said, no. I said, why not? You said they were good proposals. He said, she will never do it. I said, why? He said, listen, it's more or less what I said before, but this is a bit more precise. He said, look, the moment she walks into the EU Council, and there's the French president there, it doesn't matter who the French president is, Sarkozy, Hollande, Macron, doesn't matter. The French president never speaks, because he knows that Merkel can, like that, leave the euro. The Germans can recreate the Deutschmark. The moment you announce the breakup of the euro and the reconstruction of the Deutschmark, you know, the French franc, the Greek drachma, what's going to happen? Capital will flee, abandon France, Italy, Spain, Germany, Spain, France, Italy, Greece, and we'll all go to Frankfurt. Why? Because if you have, let's say, 1 million euros, and you have it in France, and then that becomes French francs, is why you will go down. But if you have the million euros in Frankfurt, and that becomes Deutschmark, it will go up. So anybody who has money, the moment they hear that the euro may break up, they push all their money into Germany, right? So France is destroyed the moment there is even a hint that the euro goes, whereas Germany is not destroyed. All the money goes to Germany. It's not good for Germany, because all this money going in means the Deutschmark will go up, it will be harder to sell Mercedes-Benzes to Turkey, yeah, to China. So they will have difficulties with their trade, but it will not be destroyed. France will be destroyed. So Merkel enters the room and everybody keeps their mouth shut. Right? And then he continues, if we were to adopt your proposals, suddenly the threat of a breakup of the euro goes. Suddenly we have a common debt. The European Investment Bank has issued all these bonds on behalf of everybody in Europe. The ECB is backing it. Suddenly, Germany will not be able to leave the euro. Everybody will know that. And then, and this is what the funny thing, and then he leaned towards me and he said, and then the French president will start speaking. And the chancellor cannot allow that. So, you know, that's there. So even though they recognize that that would solve the crisis, it's the political failure that stops us. So this is why we have Diem. Diem 25 is all about a transnational movement that does not think in terms of Germany, of France, of Greece, of Italy, but that we think as Europeans. And we think in terms of class. We think in terms of the German worker who is suffering because of Merkel's power. Merkel's power is purchased at the price of depressing the average worker in Germany. You know, in Germany now, since the euro, we have three times as many working poor people. People who work full-time and who are below the poverty level in Germany. So that goes in hand with the enhancement of the power of the oligarchy in Germany. So class is central. But we have to position this within an analysis of the particularities of the European Union's capitalism.
Adults in the room, right? a few more, maybe.
I was going to ask the same question that was asked a couple minutes ago about the stabilizing capitalism. That I don't agree with you at all, but I'm not sure if you told us how you are going to. Well, I was just going to ask a question about stabilizing the capitalism, that I don't agree at all.
Or that it can be done.
Like I don't agree the idea or the effort to stabilizing capitalism at all, but I'm really curious about how you are going to stabilize the politics and economics under the capitalism. I'm not sure if you told us how you are going to like stabilize politics and economics, given the fact that you give an example about the Germany's power if the Germany become, within the European Union, if we have a democratic election, Germany became a minority, right? So how are you going to like stabilize capitalism? Whether, if you are suggesting it, if you do believe it, right? So on the other side, like if you go back to, for example, Minsky, stability is destabilizing under the capitalism.
Okay, let me answer your question I'll try to honor and respect your question by splitting it into three parts. The first one is, should we want to stabilize capitalism, right? Well, this reminds me of the conversations that were going on between Marxists in the 1920s. Do we look at 1929 as a great opportunity, as capitalism is falling, to hit it over the head and replace it with socialism? That's more or less the same conversation. In the 1920s, that discussion made more sense because the left was strong. The social democrats in Germany were strong. The socialists in France were strong. And yet, even though they were strong, the fall of capitalism, the destabilization, the free fall of capitalism after 1929 did not benefit them. The only ones who were benefited by it were the Nazis and the fascists across Europe. So this is why I believe, especially now, now the left is much weaker. You know, we are non-existent politically, at the level of factories, in neighborhoods, in villages, in towns. We are non-existent now. I mean, I'm just describing the situation, let's be honest. We are a tiny minority everywhere and we're so divided compared to how we were in the 1920s. So if it was wrong in the 1920s to think that the destabilization of capitalism was a great opportunity to let it fall so that we have socialism, it is 10 times more naive to think this today. That's the first part of the question. That's why I believe stabilization is important. For one reason, allowing capitalism to topple now will not bring socialism, it will simply empower the misanthropic right. That's the first point. The second point. Of course, stability leads to instability, the Minsky argument, which is, of course, the Marx argument from Das Kapital, right? Every period of growth contains the seeds of the next crisis. We know that. That's the dialectics of it. But my argument was not to stabilize it, to keep it. My argument was to stabilize it, to keep the fascists out, to keep our people alive so they don't starve to death. So that we can plan the next step. And the next step must be a post-capitalist step. One, let me give you, for instance, an example of what I have in mind. If you ask me, what should be the aim? The aim is not the stabilization of capitalism. The means is the stabilization of capitalism. Right? What is the aim? Well, here is a dream I'll share with you. Imagine corporate law, which says that shares cannot be traded. Nobody can buy or sell shares, like you cannot buy or sell children or library cards here in the university. But that you get one share. Once you are hired in a company, you get one share. One share, one person, one vote. Everything is voted for. And once you leave the company, you give it back. And you cannot sell it. There. Right? In other words, social ownership. And imagine at the same time that you have, you know, citizens' assemblies that make sure that corporations, these cooperatives, you know, they are kept in check regarding their ecological footprint, their social impact, their social responsibility. And see, these citizens' assemblies are drawn by lot, let's say. So, you know, these are the thoughts that we have in DiEM25 regarding post-capitalism. So that's objective. Stabilizing capitalism, for me, is a way of getting there, because in my view, the collapse will only empower the fascists. And lastly, because you asked me about, you know, politics. Well, okay, all right. Well, through a mass movement, of course. There's no other way of doing it. So let me just answer that. How do we do it? Not by means of nation-state-based parties. They're finished. They are inward-looking. They have a tendency towards nationalism. They play the game of one working class against another working class. So when we created DiEM25, we chose to create it in Berlin on purpose. Solidarity with our German comrades. And we have a transnational system, mechanism. So our larger first intake membership were Germans. So we have in the same movement Germans, French people, Italians, Greeks, and now Turks. And let me give you an example. Now we have a party, our party, the party we created in Greece, is now in parliament. We have 9 members of parliament and I'm one of them. Right? Let me be very practical about how we envisage a theory of change, a theory of transformation. We have our Congress, the Greek party has its Congress coming up in May. There we will decide, change, add to our program, what we are proposing regarding, you know, industry, regarding taxation, regarding education, health, you know, property rights, our green policies, everything will be decided in the Congress. But the vote for each of these policies is going to be one that will include all DiEM members across Europe. So our comrades here in Turkey will be voting for the Greek party's policies in Greece. Similarly, the Greeks will be voting for our policies in Germany, the Italians for Britain. Even after Brexit, our British colleagues will be voting for everything we're doing in Turkey, everything we're doing in Greece, everything in France. Transnationalism, genuine internationalism, in other words, in action, which, while respecting totally the primacy of class, because this is what we are trying to do, to create class solidarity in action, not only in spirit. While preserving that, accommodates national pride, national cultures. You know, I am Greek. I'm not going to lose my, you know, affinity with Greek culture, Greek language, Greek literature, because I am transnational and an internationalist. Similarly, with our Turkish friends, our British friends, and so on, how to combine all this in a movement for change. It's very early days yet. It's either this or going back to nation state based political parties that we've tried and with which we have failed.
So we started with a woman, and let's end it with another woman. I know we are all getting tired. Our interpreter also is getting tired. So let's take one last short question and call the day.
Καλώς ήρθατε. Είμαι δημοσιογράφος, δεν είμαι ακαδημία. Αυτό θέλω να ρωτήσω... Ναι.
Turkish or English?
Don't worry. Απάντησες αγγλικά. No. Θα ρωτήσω τουρκικά, εντάξει. Yanlış nedenlerle bakan oldum dediniz. Aynı nedenlerle milletvekili olmadınız mı? O süreçten bu sürece ne değişti sizin için? Aslında DiEM DiEM 25 için sormak istiyorum. Anlattığınız her şey teoride harika ama bunları gerçekleştirmek için beni biraz ikna etmeniz lazım. Özellikle ben bir gazeteciyim. Birilerini anlatabilmem için beni biraz daha iyi ikna etmeniz lazım diye düşünüyorum. En azından Yunanistan'da, tüm Avrupa'da etkili olmak istediğinizi söylüyorsunuz. Hatta Avrupa dışında olabilecek ülkelerde de etkili olmak istediğinizi söylüyorsunuz. Ama bize en azından Yunanistan'daki somut örneklerinizi anlatabilir misiniz? Yeni bir parti kurdunuz ve 10 kişi olarak meclistesiniz. Neler yapacaksınız ve DiEM İkosipen'de nasıl ilerleyecek? Mevcut sistem buna ne kadar izin verecek?
Okay, to begin with, let me clarify what I meant, that I was elected for the wrong reasons. I didn't mean to say that exactly. What I said was I never wanted to be a politician. I would never have become a politician if it wasn't for the major crisis that pushed our people in Greece into a debtor's prison. It would not have happened. I've always been a political animal, always been politically active, but I never cared to be elected. I was quite happy to be part of movements, student movements, you know, academic movements, trade unions. Always worked very closely with trade unions when I lived in Australia. So it was a historical accident, because it so happened that I was placed in the academy and had good relationship with journalists, so they listened to me, or they actually interviewed me. So at some point when Greece became bankrupt, I said, we became bankrupt and we have to embrace the bankruptcy and not try to pretend we didn't get bankrupt. That made me a figure of hatred. Yeah, I was hated by the establishment. And when a few years later, a young man who was going to be prime minister in a few weeks said to me, look, I agree with everything you say that we should do, but we don't have the expertise to do it, and you've got to come on board and do it as a finance minister, I had the moral duty to say yes. So that's a historical accident. In a sense, we are all creatures of historical accidents. DiEM25 emerged as a result of the euro crisis, of the crisis of our generation after 2008. But you said you're not convinced. Well, nor am I. Nobody's convinced. Because how do you transform your analysis into, we had the previous question, okay, so what's our theory of change? How do we affect change? How do we do it? I have no idea. Anybody who tells you that they know, they are lying. Because this is a fundamental transformation. But you know what? History was written by people who at some point said, I'm not going to take this anymore. I'm not going to contribute to the reproduction of the problem. I'm going to take action because, life is short and then you die. And I'm going to make sure that whatever propensities, whatever capacities I have, I put them into the service of that which must happen. Do we have a good theory of what needs to be changed? I think we have a very good one. I think our analysis of climate change, of the debt crisis, of private debt, of the low level of investment, of the effect of artificial intelligence on work, on the distribution of income, I think this is much better than those who are in government. Do we have good people amongst us? Yes, we do. We have people who don't want to be politicians. This is essential. Anybody who wants to be a minister should be immediately disqualified. Immediately. Like in universities, right? Are we going to succeed? I have no idea. Probably not. But so what? Every time I wake up in the morning, I know that someday I will be dead. That's no reason for me to be upset. Yeah? I will use my day in the best possible manner in order to affect that which I can affect. For us, at DiEM25, and for my friends, for my the people that I associate with, trying without having a blueprint to create together, to crowdsource the blueprint of putting into practice that which we know needs to be put into practice is a reason for existing.
Thank you, Yanis. It was a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for coming. Let's give him a big applause before he leaves.